Well, thank you very much for inviting me here and being part of this lecture. This is for you. You are welcome to ask me any questions you want at the end, and I would be honored to answer those to the best of my ability. This is actually my 40th year in business. Think about this. 40 years ago, I sat where you're sitting now at college. In my parents' basement, I had 57 aquariums, and I bred and raised tropical fish and sold them, so my parents said this man ought to be an oceanographer. I'm like, okay. So I went to college for biological oceanography for 2 years, but then I realized it wasn't about the fish, it was about the buying and selling. It was my gift. One of the first lessons that I want to give you today, one of the first seeds I want to plant you today is this. Look for your gifts and talents. Each and every one of you is called to be a world changer, to change the world around you. Look for those gifts and talents. I call it your sweet spot. And when you're in your sweet spot, you get this great peace and this great joy because it's where you're meant to be. So for me, again, father of 17 children, 7 grandchildren, more family growing. It's 12 adopted from around the world. I like to call us the international family. It's been such an honor to watch how the Lord has worked in our lives to grow us and to make a difference in this world. I live here in Elizabethtown, Pennsylvania, and again, DAS, the company that's been entrusted to me, started 18 years ago with a vision, sitting in your seats, to sell product at Roots and Green Dragon Farmers Market, if you've ever heard of it, and flea markets. I started with $700. My grandmother's garage, again, never despise small beginnings. This was our official warehouse in 1978. With my father's station wagon, I sold my bicycle and everything else I owned. I raised $700 and started a journey in business. That has grown now to employ over 700 associates that are part of our company worldwide, office in China, and then in Salt Lake City, Utah, in Chicago, in Virginia, warehouses in Salt Lake City, and also here in Elizabethtown, and in Palm Harbor, Pennsylvania. That has grown to over $400 million in sales, and now is the leader in travel center industry merchandise and marketing worldwide. That, if you ever stop at a travel center, which would be like a Pilot or a Lounge or a Petro or these types of customers, Flying J, walk in and look, you'll see little tags that say DAS. That was the beginning, Dave Abel Stereo, DAS. And those products, over 6,000 of them, we manufacture in China, India, Vietnam, and here in the USA under our own brands, and we distribute worldwide. So stop at a travel center. You'll see about 4,000 different items that we do distribute to travel centers worldwide. And through the grace of God and a series of events that you couldn't write the script for, we became the largest in the world, but it didn't start that way. Never despise beginnings of small things. So for me, I was buying and selling. It's what I like to do at Roots and Green Dragon Farmers Market. But here's one of the keys that I did. I always listened to what the customer wanted, what the customer needed, and then I go search it out. And if the customer had a question, I never answered it with what I thought was truth. I always looked up truth and then had the idea for the next time. So key in business, always when you're in it, listen to a customer's need, then fill that need. I remember when I first started selling consumer electronics, which I didn't have a clue about, woofer, tweeter, you know, mid-range, wow, and flutter, what is all that? But I learned it. And every time they'd come back the next week, I'd have the correct answer. I remember going and calling my first stereo stores. Here was the key question. What are your customers looking for that you can't find? And I'll never forget the answer again and again. Now you're a little bit young to remember this. They said, we're looking for 8-track to cassette adapters because cassettes were going to be the hot new thing. And they couldn't find them. So I went out and found an audio box, CA-106, and I bought that product and sold it. It gave me my entree into consumer electronics. Once I entered the door, that I always tried to find out how I could continue to serve them to build their business. And so our business grew through the 80s, and it was phenomenal. In the late 1980s, I learned about truck stops. Like, what's a truck stop? Isn't that where truckers go and eat and drink and shower, whatever, and they're back on the road? No, they sold my products. So what did I do? Another key learning lesson. I learned the customer. I learned what they sold. I looked at what they did and said, how can I be a value add? How can I do for them what's not being done today? So what I did is I went out to the major retailers who were much better than me in marketing and distributing and said, what are they doing? Now, how can I do what they're doing in their displays, in their merchandising, in their product mix? How can I bring it back into the industry of truck stops? And so I started developing products that would be unique to that market that wasn't there before. I would develop planograms in those stores, and then those planograms would have the products on that the truckers would buy. Well, all of a sudden, that took 5 years. At the end of 5 years, which was 1992, I had lost over $5 million trying to get into this industry. It was a good old boy industry. And people didn't want to switch. They wanted to stay with who did it best for them, who wanted the coffee and donuts, who was their buddy that played golf with them. And no matter what I did, I couldn't break into this industry. So one day I said, I'm done. This is 1992. I said, I'm done. I can't do it anymore. I have no more money. I have $1.8 million of inventory I need to sell. And so my competitor had called me and said, we're going to buy you. So we developed the price structure, what we were going to do. They did their due diligence. In 1992, I sold our truck stop division for $3 million. I was done. I couldn't do it anymore. But here's another key learning lesson. I got on a plane and flew to Chicago to collect the check. And when I got out there, they lied to me. You see, when you set the core compass of your company, core means heart. Okay, what's the heart of your company? When I went out there, they deceived me and they lied to me. I said, take me back to the airport. I'm going home. They reduced the price to $500,000, offered to have me sell car washes, and knew that my numbers now, because they booked them all, I couldn't survive financially. They said, would you go over to China and source product for us? I said, I'll never do that. I learned a valuable lesson. Never say never to God, because when you do, he laughs. Well, when they didn't give me my $3 million check, they didn't buy that part of my company, I flew home, and I called a man from Korea who worked with me, and I said, will you go to China with me? Because in order to survive, we must be both the manufacturer, the importer, and the distributor. And that's important to control your destiny. When you're the manufacturer, you're the importer, and you're the distributor, you make money in every section. There is nothing wrong with making a profit. I'm going to give you another really key point here. I like to call this, these are lessons I learned from a man named Bernie Leibowitz who owned that fish place in Lancaster. He taught me three critical lessons. He said, David, when you go to buy a product, he said, look at the product, and if you can buy it and sell it for what you paid, buy it, there's virtually no risk. Did you get that? When you go and you source a product, and you believe you can sell it for what you paid for it, buy it, there's no risk. Then he said the next one. David, don't worry about what you paid. Too many people in business say, I paid 50 cents, I'm gonna sell it for a dollar, I doubled my money. Isn't that great? You doubled your money. No, you lost 500% of what you could have made. He said, David, look and see what will the market bear that will give a value to the consumer, a profit to the customer, and what you make, you're entitled to make. So I'll never forget a butane torch that we would buy for truckers, and I paid 50 cents for that over in China. Now, somebody would say, man, you sold it for $2, you'd be doing great. No, here's the key. Look what the market will bear. I looked at the market. Those products are being sold for $30 and $40 at retailers. I said, you know what, we can give our customers a great value at $19.95. 60% of $19.95 is $8 our customers, our consumers, the retail stores, the truck stops, they can make 60% on that $20 ring. The consumer's going to save $10 a unit, and I'm going to sell it for $8, and I only paid 50 cents. That's understanding your market, understanding what it will bear, giving the value not only to the consumer, but the profit to the store that's selling it, and what you make, you're entitled to make. Very key learning lesson. Too many people have left way too much money on the table that they could have made, which helps their company grow, because they didn't really take the time. Because once you price a product, it's done. It's over. It's priced. It's out there. You can't take it back. So for me, everybody got a value. Everybody made money. Another key piece of that, when you get the product, is what one of the gifts that I have, which is merchandising and marketing. And I like to use a simple little expression, simple, stupid. I have to answer every consumer's question, God bless you, on that package that I develop that make that customer say, I need that, or I want that. So again, answer the question on the package, every one of them. Every one of them. Don't ever assume the end consumer knows the answer. They don't. And I would go, so here's another key thing that I did. I would go at a truck stop, and I would stand in our section, and I would listen to the end consumer. And I'd listen to their questions. Does this antenna that says it's made for a car, will it work on a truck? Well, of course it will, but no. It's a learning lesson. I need to answer that and add it to my marketing and packaging. Car, truck, van, motorhome. Again, simple, stupid marketing. So, I ended up coming back, going over to China, sourcing product. 6 months later, my competitor called me and said, hey, we want to buy you now. But you see, whenever morals or ethics are not lined up with your core values, the heart of your company, and for me, my number one core value, which before you leave, our core values are here, is God honoring. God honoring. I set my compass to that. Morals, ethics, never go against it. Watch this story as it unfolds. So they said to me 6 months later, hey, we're going to buy you. I'm going to give you $3 million. I said, no. I said, I'm okay right now. I'm not going to sell my company. In 2008, through a series of events, we had an opportunity to buy that company, who had bought all my competition for the most part. We cut a deal, $36 million. We're going to buy my competitor. We are going to be the largest in the world. We had bought all the competitors who used to talk about us, who mocked us, who made fun of us, who tried to put us out of business. Awesome. So the deal was cut. They were doing a final phone conversation before we got everything, all the checks and the money and everything. So I took my kids to school on the way back and came into the office. They said, David, you need to go on that phone call. There's a problem. I said, okay, but we have everything signed. There shouldn't be a problem. I go up, and the same company, Morals and Ethics, I said, are you willing to warrant and wrap this? In other words, what you're presenting to me, your numbers, your cost structure, your inventory? They said, no, that's up to you. I said, how about this? Are you willing to warrant and wrap this? No, we're not going to do that. Three things they wouldn't stand behind, which morally and ethically any company would stand behind. I said, then we don't have a deal. I walked out. Yes, I did slam the door. And I left. So I got home, the man had already called me and said, hey, we got a deal. We'll make it work. I never called him back. Never do business and never deal with people who don't have the same moral and ethical compass that you run your company by. Whenever you're involved in something that's not morally and ethically correct, walk away. You may not understand the consequences if you enter into it, but I guarantee you they will come back to bite you. And if you watch again and again and again, companies that have fallen, look back at where they went away and strayed from their core mission, their core values. And so that company, who didn't sell to me in 2008, because I walked away because of morals and ethics, a friend of mine who was financially going to help me at that time, said, David, the Lord's going to give you that company. I'm like, well, that's impossible. That'll never happen. Well, remember 2008, what happened?
The market
crash, major recession. Think of this. Had I bought that company then, with a $36 million debt, I would have lost my company. I would have never been able to make the payments. 2008. But guess what else happened? They were affected. 3 years later, we bought that company from the bank for pennies on the dollar. Pennies on the dollar. Morals and ethics. One time I remember we bought GoPro, we developed all this new product, it was really, really hot, the truck stopped. We got a call from what then was one of the top two retailers in the country, consumer retailers, not truck stops. So I was like, oh, I'm all excited. I flew out to Chicago. This is great. They're going to buy my product. I was like, I couldn't believe it. This is going to make our name. So I flew out to Chicago, met with the buyer, met with the rep who had invited me to come out to view this buyer. They were going to put in a section every one of their stores nationally. $6 million opening order, $2.5 million profit of the opening order. Isn't that awesome? Then at the end of the meeting, morals and ethics. The buyer said, well, let me explain to you how this works. We rate every PO, what you do at the end when you submit the PO, you send 1% check to the buyer of this company, to his home, and a 1% check to me as the rep at my home. Now, I'm not stupid, but I wanted to ask them to clarify it for me. I said, can you explain it to me? He said, well, that's just the way we do business here at this major retailer. And he explained it to me. I said, sir, that's not morally or ethically correct. He said, well, if you don't do that, you will never do business with our company ever. And I said, well, sir, then I shut my briefcase. I said, sir, then I guess I'll never do business with your company. And they took me to the airport, and guess what? 3 years later, that major retailer filed bankruptcy. They would have owed me over $10 million had I been greedy and took was a $2.5 million profit and took that order. And once again, I lost my company. Continuing on my journey, our company went through in 1991, our company went through a little trial. The man that our accountant had recommended, or the woman that our accountant had recommended our company hire as a controller, was taught by our accountant what to do. It was called the fix-it method. And in 1992, came to find out that my numbers were wrong, and I was $1 million short current receivables to current liabilities. Effectively, bankrupt. What do? You take all the money out you can and let it go bankrupt? Or do you do the morally and ethically correct thing, which is one of the most painful things of my life? In 90 days, I closed 4 locations, let go 60 people, went back down from 158 to 98 people, sold and refinanced my home, sold everything else I could get my hands on, and put every dollar into the company. And then, what did I learn from that? Because we are called to learn from our mistakes. I made a mistake in trusting 100% in the ability of the young lady who trusted in the accountant. Don't do that. So the key learning lesson here, know your numbers. Know your numbers intimately. From that day forth, I can promise you, I know my numbers intimately. I will never trust them to somebody else. That started me on a journey to rebuild the company, and thank you, Lord, it came down to that October, the bank had called the loan, that another bank came along, and we made $142,000 that year, and we continued on down the journey. So as our company continued to grow, and we're growing in the industry, nothing else happened to me. All right, lots of things happened. But about 12 years ago, I hit the wall at about 1,000 miles an hour, broke into about 1 million pieces. pieces emotionally. I had had a problem since age 8 with an addiction that I couldn't break free from, and I didn't really care if I lived or died. If you looked at me, the said man made it. He's wealthy, he's got a successful company, beautiful wife, all these children. He's the American dream. But they wouldn't have seen was a great ache in my heart. Because I tried to buy stuff to fill the ache. I tried to pour myself into business to satisfy the ache. I did everything to satisfy the ache. Because I couldn't break free from the addiction. But it started at age 8 in my father's closet and grew to own and control me. So I thank you, Lord, in November 2004, I got set free from that addiction. And here's the great lesson that I learned from that I'm going to give to each of you. Because if somebody said, here's $1 million, or here's the lesson, I take the lesson. And the lesson is this. It's called a balanced life. My life, I call it BC, before Christ in my life, my life priority for this, self, me, myself, and I, stuff. I bought a lot of stuff. $1.2 million worth of stuff I bought in 2004 to fill this great ache, and it doesn't work. Business. These were the priorities of my life. Business. Pour myself into business. Then children. Then spouse. God didn't make my list. And God needed to rebuild me. My list today, for the last 11 years, it's almost 12 years now, is this. My number one thing on my list of priorities is my relationship with God. The Bible is the blueprint of how we're to live our lives, to run our businesses, to court our beloved. It's the blueprint. It's what gives us what the world can't and that money can't buy. It's what fills the great ache. The number one leader in this world that changed the world, whether you believe he's God or not, is your choice. I'm not here to convince you of that. But Jesus Christ, 2,000 years ago, walked this earth. What year is it right now? 2016. What year does that represent? The birth of Christ. The whole world looks at that, for the most part, looks at that year. He walked this earth and changed this earth, changed this world for the better. Why? Another key learning lesson for each of you, he was a servant leader. He helped other people identify their gifts and talents. He helped build them up so that what he did in affirming them in their gifts and talents, getting them in their sweet spots, they became world changers. World changers. So my life today, number one, a relationship with God. It's through that relationship that everything else flows through me. Number two on that list, I learned the hard way. Our choices have consequences. Our choices have consequences. My number two on my list is my spouse, my beautiful, beautiful wife. Tierney's here with me today, and I thank her so much for being here with me. But number two is my spouse, because in the past, she didn't make number two. Business did. Work did. My addictions did. So number two is my spouse. Number three are my children. Number three are my children. What I sow into them, what I invest into them, both they and I will reap. We're teaching our children what it means to be a good steward. What does that look like? We gift money to them every year. And then we encourage them to gift half of that to charities of their choice to be world changers. Be world changers. The topic of my talk is not just about a paycheck, but about a purpose. And we're going to come to the wrap up of that here very shortly. And so number four on my list is what I like to call mission opportunities. They are the workplace, they are the community, they are the church. That's my mission opportunity. How can I be an instrument of change to change the world that's around me? And it's not about money, and it's not about stuff. We have a perfect example of that in a young 14-year-old girl who said her yes. There's two, but I'm going to go with one a little bit later in our lives. Her name was Mother Teresa. She said, yes, I'm going to serve the poorest of the poor. And she got off the train in India to coddle a man who was dying of leprosy on the street corner and died in her arms. It changed her life. She had no money. She had no stuff. She had two things to wear. But yet, her gift of her life changed the world for positive, made the world a better place. And that ripple effect of the gift of her life is changing the world today. That's your call. Each and every one of you are called to be world changers. And as leaders, you've been given a special gift. Whether you own a company or you lead a group of people, those people are entrusted to you. See, the way I look at it, the company, DAS, I don't own it. I'm just the steward. I'm the caretaker of it. How can I use that company to, number one, take care of the family of the people that are entrusted to me? They give to me, the workers, the greatest that they can give me of their life. They invest more time with the company than they do their families, for the most part. So how can I make a difference in their life? Hence comes not just about a paycheck, about a purpose. So what I do is I meet with them every year, and I share with them how the gift of their life in the company, we work together. Because if it was just all about me, myself, and I can't do what they do. I'm not computer literate. My wife will correct me and say, hey, you text. I don't think that's computer literate. Hey, you can answer an email. I don't think that's computer literate. It's not my gift. It's not my comfort zone. So what do? I hire people who are. You know, I'm not the chairman of the board of the company. You know, I argued with the Lord when I stepped out 10 years ago. I said, hey, Lord, I got to be chairman of the board. 30 years of my life in this company, not your gifts and talents. I argued 3 times. I said, but it's my company. Whose company? Well, it's your company. I said, but I should be that. And then I realized, chairman of the board, not my gifts and talents. So again, I hired a man that had those gifts and talents. So for me, what I invest in children, what I do in mission opportunities in the workplace and as leaders, critically important to make this world a better place. And number 5 on the list is self. How do I keep myself physically and spiritually in shape to make the journey of each day? What did make the list? Stuff. Stuff can't buy you happiness. Stuff can't buy you happiness. So my life has changed. The last 12 years of my life has been a great adventure. I was a dead man walking. I didn't care if I lived or died in 2004. Today I watch as God helps me to be a world changer every day. And guess what it comes from? The simplest acts. I like to call it acts of random kindness. I go into a Turkey Hill just this past week, and I see a woman standing there with 2 loaves of bread, a gallon of milk, and a dozen eggs. And that little inspiration in my heart, pay for that for her. And so I said, oh, ma'am, can I buy that for you? Can I help you and buy that for you? It'd be a blessing to you. She said, are you sure, sir? I said, absolutely, I'd be honored. So I bought it for her. Boom, when I got back, and just that ability to be a gift to her, amazing. And then the burly truck driver behind me says, hey, that really touched me. I'm going to buy the guy's coffee behind me. Love is contagious. And when we do these acts of random kindness, we become world changers. It's not in the big, it's in the little. You know, it's in the little. I was a jury duty for 7 days, and I come walking out of the parking garage. And again, we have to have eyes to see, we have to have ears to hear, and we have to have a heart to respond. And I see a woman sitting on a bench. And when I saw her, boom, I had that little inspiration. Offer her a $20 bill to make a difference in her life. She was homeless, I could tell that. I'd see her bag sitting there, I could see her clothes, the way she was dressed. So I said, ma'am, may I bless you and give you a gift? Listen to what she said. Oh, sir, I'm not a Christian. Oh, I said, ma'am, there's no prerequisite. It's a lot. I would just love to give you a gift. And she lit up, her eyes teared up. She said, thank you, sir. And I gave her the gift. And I said, here's the key. Then I made it personal. I said, put your name. She told me her name. I said, would you mind if I prayed for you? I just see a little tears running down her eyes. She said, sir, I would really like that. I would really like that. Acts of random kindness are each and every one of you experience those, I like to call them God moments every day, where you too can be called to change the world. You don't know difference that it made. That seed, that prayer for the woman on the bench. Because I went up to the lady that was in the car, I bought the milk and the bread, knocked on her window, and I told her the story of a man behind me, the burly truck driver, and the tears had started rolling down her face, and she said, "Sir, I learned a lesson years ago. When people want to bless me, I let them bless me. Because when I used to say, 'No, I don't need it,' it wasn't true." And she said, "I was actually robbing them of the ability to be a blessing to them." So, sir, thank you for following that prompting in your heart, and thank you for blessing me. Young men and young women, all of us, you're called to be world changers. You're called to make a difference. It's not just about a paycheck. It's about a purpose. As we instill that in our company, this understanding of stewardship, which is everything we have, is a gift from God that we're to do what with? Use it for me, myself, and I know that we're to use to help others. I have watched our company rally behind associates with cancer, associates who lost a loved one. Amazing stories. Last year, we built up or refurbished a home. All our associates helped. They raised money. They did the work. We paid them to do it. We gave that home away. Another year, we gave $50 to every associate. We said, get together in small groups, pool your money, and see if you can multiply that in 90 days. They went from $18,700 to $58,600. And then we said, now, you give it away to charities that touch your heart. It's amazing when you're out there and you make it not just about a paycheck, but about a purpose. When you realize every encounter you have every day is an opportunity, and you got to make a choice to be that blessing, to be that affirmation in someone's gift, or not. It happens every day. So, ladies and gentlemen, that's kind of my story, a little bit early, but a couple key things I want to also leave you with. As you're starting your journey, another key learning lesson for me is start out slowly. Crawl, then walk, then run, never zoom. A priest friend of mine said, "David, he said, I don't do that. He said, I start out, I run splat, run splat, run splat." But it's true. In whatever you're doing in business or anything, start out crawl. In order for a baby to walk, first you have to crawl. Crawl, then walk, then run. Don't zoom. Setting the compass, again, the core values, I cannot encourage you enough. The millions and millions and millions and millions and millions of dollars that we lost, because you heard the stories where I did follow the morals and ethics. I had lots of stories where I didn't. And they were hard lessons. I shared with you that I suffered from addiction. Choices have consequences. Choices do have consequences. After 30 years of marriage, my wife and I got divorced. I went through the most painful period of 7 years of my life. 4 years we tried to heal, we weren't successful. 3 years I lived by myself virtually, just caring for the children and running to my bedroom to heal. Not a pleasant journey. Our choices have consequences. Each of you are going to make choices when you leave here today. Trust me, it may not be tomorrow, but choices have consequences. I thank the Lord for the redemption and the healing and the resurrection that did occur after that in me, in my former spouse who's married and is beautiful, and what's happening to children, and with me and the gift of my wife, Tyranny, that the Lord brought into my life. So again, choices have consequences. Can't tell you that enough. Grab a sheet on the core values, learn it. Our number one's God honor. Our number two is family. We consider every associate that works for us part of our family. We listen to their hearts. We have funds set aside when they have troubles to help them. We do courses at our company to help them manage finances. We do whatever we can do. One time we hired, she's still with us, we hired our human developer, our HR person. And she said, David, I can terminate 100 employees a day and make you millions of dollars. You don't need them. I said, you know what? I appreciate that. But that's not what this company's founded on. We have associates who work with us that have had brain tumors, can't really work anymore. They read their sentences backwards. Guess what? We kept them employed. And we had somebody else help them. Why? Because they considered us their second family. We had another man fell over with a stroke. He was my first employee. 35 years he gave me the company. He couldn't even go out and pick the orders correctly because he couldn't, his brain didn't work right enough. Guess what? Until the day he retired, probably 5 or 6 years later, we kept him. We kept him employed. Why? Because we're part of his family. So again, God honoring families, number two. Number three, servant leadership. 2,000 years ago, Jesus Christ passed on his gifts and talents. He helped people understand how he lived his life. So why? So what he did could be replicated in others that our world changes. That's what you're called to do. That's what you're called to be. So for me, servant leadership, identifying other people with their gifts, affirming in them in those gifts, and then helping them rise up. Had a man come to me. His name is Steve. He worked in our warehouse. When he first came to me, he came for a job interview. I interviewed him, and I said, you're not going to get the job, and he left. So I ran down the hall. I said, hey, look, let me tell you why you didn't get the job. The next interview you go to, this is what you need to do differently. 3 months later, put that in the paper for a job opening in a warehouse. He comes in and does exactly what I told him to do. I hired him in the warehouse. That man, because of his gifts and talents, he gave it his all in the warehouse, in sales, in marketing, in management. Today, he makes over $600,000 a year as our truck stop division vice president. He started in the warehouse. So no matter what your job is, no matter what position you take, give it your all. Give it your all. The next thing, integrity. You cannot compromise. You cannot compromise morals and ethics. For me, my compass is sacred scripture, the Bible. It's what I go to. Done. Can't compromise. And again, I can tell you hundreds of stories, both good and when I didn't follow it, back in what I call BC days. The next one on my list is humility. Pride is the root of all evil. Humility is this. I am not DAS. I am not the owner. It's not me that did it. It takes a team. It takes the marketing department, the sales department, the returns department. It takes every person in the company to be successful. Humility, humility, humility is key to recognizing that it's everyone that makes it happen. Because when you let pride in, I did that. I got that customer. I this. I guarantee you. We just haven't had him in our company. Love the man. But he couldn't get over his pride. It was all about him. He's no longer with our company. And it's so sad. He could have been. Okay? So humility. Quality. Another key thing. When I look at all my competition, they cut the quality out to make more money. The more quality they cut out, the more money they could make because they thought the truckers had nowhere else to go. I went in and I said, no. Let's put all the quality back in. And we'll create a platinum series and we'll help the truckers get a real value for their money. Never, ever cut quality. Quality of your service, quality of your products. And last, profitability. Know your numbers. Know your numbers intimately. There is nothing wrong with making fair profit. Always be truthful. And for us, our big customers, we have one customer that does $150 million. Guess what? We tell them, we're here to make money, and you need us to make money. Because when we make money, we invest in the future. And that's what they want, a healthy organization. So ladies and gentlemen, young men and women, before you leave, grab a gap of core value. I'm going to open it up to questions now. I hope the nuggets that I gave you, you took note of, because I paid a lot of money to learn them. And I'm a wide open book for you guys. I'm here to help you. I'm here to help you. So with that, I'm going to open up the questions.
Dave?
Yes?
Do you want to say a word about Brittany Soap, since we have such a partnership with the college?
sure, this is another learning lesson in life. So in 1999, my daughter called me the day before. She got a dozen donuts that morning, next morning, drove them into my office, hit black ice, hit a tree, broke her neck, killed her. 23 years old and 6 months out of college. She was our first adopted daughter. Thank you, Lord. I stayed at home that morning because the kids had an hour delay. So I was an hour behind the accident. On the same road, I'm driving to work. I see the car. I see it right around the tree. I know she didn't leave or didn't live. I get out of the car, and the paramedic, I said, did the girl in that car live? And of course, when he heard me say that, he knew I knew the person. And so my daughter died. And the key to this is this. As we were picking out the final clothes that she ever wear, the Lord spoke to our hearts and said, out of her death could come life. And her dream of helping other special needs children, she was age 12 when we adopted her. Her mother was dying of a brain tumor. They interviewed her. She picked us to raise her 12-year-old daughter. Out of her death could come life. Her dream of helping other special needs children worldwide find the love of a mother and father, we heard. You see, every one of us are going to have a lot of things happen in our lives, positive and negative. We can either live in the negative, my daughter died, and I can go into a closet, and I can beat myself up, and I can do all kinds of things, and woe boys me. Or we can listen and try and make a difference with that gift of her life. So you know what? Brittany's hope started from that. People donated $25,000 from vendors and factories for her funeral, and to give to a charity and say, let's start this. Well, to date, over 900 children have come home to loving families through financial grants. Orphanages have been built, schools have been built, amazing work in predominantly Ethiopia, Kenya, and Vietnam. But what could have been a life changer for the negative, when you look at it correctly, is changing the world for a positive. And people all over the world, from factories in China to factories all over this country, are being touched by the story of Brittany's hope. So that our company, which is now like our philanthropic arm, our company is sharing that message. I'll speak in May to the biggest truck stop show in the world, and I'll share the story about them to make a difference in their company, to enlist their vendors, their customers, to make it not just about a paycheck, but about a purpose. So that's the story of Brittany. So again, I encourage you to learn about it. Go on one of our trips. It's awesome. And again, every day you're going to be faced with it. You can choose positive, or you can choose negative. Negative will bring you down. Positive will change the world. Other questions? Yes, you had a question. Yes?
I have a personal question, so if you don't
want to
answer it.
Oh, sure. No, you're fine. Go ahead. You can ask it.
Have you heard of the Wolf of Wall Street?
Say this?
Have you heard of the Wolf of Wall Street?
I have, but I have not read it or seen it before.
But the movie kind of like glorifies these of the Wall Street investment bankers. The movie kind of glorifies it. Drugs, sex, and alcohol, and like the book is a very dynamic view of it, and then it shows like all consequences of all that. So, as college kids, like, especially living in a modern society where like drugs and alcohol are kind of glorified as like drinking, drinking, stress, like, things like that. Like, what's your perspective? And how do you think, what are like some good solutions?
Key thing is this, and I'm just giving my own personal life journey. And it was my grandfather, it was my father, it was me. Sexually addicted to pornography, alcohol addicted, gambling addicted. Never drug addicted, none of our family ever was in that. But those addictions were really a longing and going into the world to fix the great ache in the heart. You say to relieve stress? Absolutely, I did it. I'm like, oh, but it doesn't. It does the opposite. Here's the key. When we go to substances or people or whatever, notoriety stuff to quench our thirst, it's like drinking salt water. Looks good. You can even be cold, but it's going to kill you. And for me, I'm going to be honest with you, it wasn't until I truly had that life-changing experience and I drank what I call living water, what's called living water in scriptures, then my life changed. When my life changed, it became not just about what the world could give me, it didn't become that anymore. It was about how can I make a difference in other people's lives. So when you do that, when you slow down, I think slowing down, we speed everything up too much. Slow down. Now, when you help, when you realize that what you did saved a baby's life, changed a person's life, helped them be set free, I'm telling you that what happens in your heart is this great gift that money can't buy, which is joy, peace, the gift of the Spirit. So for me, my encouragement, it's your choice. Just start. Slow down. Start your day. Do a little bit of reading in the New Testament and say, hey, what do you want to speak to me today? And wait, here's the key. Ask the Lord, how can I be a world changer? How can I go out and just do acts of random kindness? Use me today. Here's the key of my morning prayer. Grant me the gifts of the eyes to see, the ears to hear, and a heart to respond. I promise you, your life will change. And guess what? You'll accomplish more than if you get into Zoom of the moment. I hope that helps you. You're welcome. Other questions? Don't be shy. Don't be shy. Yes.
Okay. How do you feel like your business management style has changed since you actually created?
Well, there are employees that were afraid to knock on the door of my office. They would actually tremble and almost virtually cry because of my anger and my, I wasn't a nice person. I wasn't, I'm being honest with you. Those employees, one of them had left, came back to work for me. They love it now. They will tell you I've changed because I have this inner peace. I don't worry, I don't have anxiety, I'm at peace. But all this stuff still happens around me, but I have what they don't have, which is peace. And so it's contagious to the work, but how do you have that? I try to help people attain that peace. So I've changed. And you know what else? Here's the key. In order to win, you have to surrender. I surrender the outcome of everything to the Lord. I have a total peace. If it's meant to happen, it'll happen. And that's surrender. Because pride, I could have bought that company in 2008. I could have made it happen. I had the money. It was pride. I lost my company. So when I surrender, it's amazing what I see happen and get accomplished. And it's freedom. If it happens, great. If it doesn't, I'm okay. I can do my part. I can study for exams. I can do my part, but I'm at peace. And that's a huge, huge, huge awakening for me. Other questions? Yes?
Did you not add to that hiring the right people?
Oh, yes. One of the key things as a leader is make sure that everybody reflects, especially if you're a business owner, reflects you, which reflects your core values. Very, very, very key. And if they don't, they gotta go. I've had to fire the best salesman I ever had. He could make me more money. I didn't even understand how he did it. It was unbelievable. But the other salesman would come to me and say, hey, this guy does this, he says this, he does this, he does that. At that time, it's in the early 90s, I needed the money, I needed the profits, I couldn't let it go. So I brought him into the office because I found out, all these things he was going to say, you can't do it again, I'm not going to terminate you. He left my office that morning, and that afternoon, another salesman came in and said, David, let me tell you what he did now. He looked at the computer, he found my customers out. He found out what they're paying for it. He then sold it to his customers for less money and then gave my customers to him to sell to those customers at less money than I was, so he would make more money. And I went, oh. And I had to fire him. One of the most healthiest things I've ever done. So it's really key that everyone in the company, every associate, everybody working with you reflects those core values, your heart, because they represent you to the marketplace. Yes?
What did the man do in his job interview to not get hired?
What did the man do?
You
mean the young man who, he went out, and I don't know what he did, he went to another job interview, his mother brought him to this one. He went out, and next thing you know, 3 months later, when he came back, he interviewed with me again. What did he do? What was that specific thing? You know what? I wish I could remember that. I don't. But whatever he did on that job interview, I was honest with him. I said, here's what you did wrong. I don't remember. I apologize. But he listened to me. You see, the worst thing we can do, here's another key piece of advice. Communicate. I'm a visionary. I'm merchandising and marketing. But as a visionary, I gotta write it down. I gotta write the vision down. I gotta make sure everybody is clear. And when you have associates that work for you, another key valuable point, every 3 months, let them know how they're doing. And don't be untruthful. Tell them the truth. Make sure they know. Give them encouragement on what to change. Because when you fail to communicate, it causes a lot of problems. I've done it way too many times. And it gets a whole company out of kilter. So again, communicate, and do it in writing. Do it in writing. So many times we have been saved because we had it in writing. Again, another nugget of wisdom. Anything else? Final questions. Well, I hope and pray that all the gifts that I've given you, you take them. They're invaluable. They'll help you on your journey. Remember your calling, your world changer. Identify your gifts, affirm others in theirs, go change the world. God bless each and every one of you.